And also, we'll help in the mitigation of the COVID symptoms, COVID complications, and the era of the post-COVID complications also. We are very much know the pathologist plays a major role on us on date in identifying and giving us who is the culprit, who is the problematic fellow, and what are the problems, and how to go ahead on the problems. So this is very important in Indian Medical Association. Today also we are getting a lot of pathological things are happening, and we are in the process of identifying them and fighting it against very actively against these pathological things, which is distressing the peaceful atmosphere of healthcare delivery system. We are seeing the violence which is happening on us on the physical front, violence taking on us the mental and the psychological level, and we are also seeing the violence which is taking in our profession itself. So all this also we need to fight on this as we make a commitment to fight against COVID, to safeguard our profession, safeguard our people of this country. Equally, at this moment, I appeal to all the participants, let us take a commitment that we will fight against all the pathological events which is creating violence on our profession and professionals in the days to come. I know for sure that you are looking forward to hear the very important lecture from Dr. Avinesh Patke. I thank them from the IMA headquarters for taking pain to participate at this moment. I'm so happy there is more than 120 people have joined this program, and that will be beneficial. Also, this lecture will be available in our website. It will be continuously available. People can see that in that future days to come also. I once again thank Dr. Narendra Saini sir for his willingness to be the moderator. I am sure it will be a good feast for us. Thank you very much. I thank Harshad ji for taking pain to organize in such a important lecture at this moment. Thank you all, and thank you very much for this opportunity.
Yeah, thank you, NP sir, and definitely this is a very important lecture because, as you said, the investigations, but when to do and how to do and how much to do, you know, because the crucial period and the crucial time every investigation has got, and that is what the important is. And we are going to listen to Dr. Avinash for the same thing. So I would, without wasting time, I will request Dr. Narendra Saini. As I mentioned, he is our past HSG from Delhi. He himself is a pathologist. So I requested Dr. Saini, and he was more than willing to accept this, and he has accepted to be the moderator for this lecture. Over to Dr. Saini for your introduction and then for the lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lele, and thank you, Dr. Jalal, and eminent leaders of IMA who are there, who are at present a listener to this program. Thank you so much for choosing me as a moderator. We know that for the last one year, I think 1.5 years now, starting from November, December 2019, we are struggling with this pandemic. And this virus is known to behave differently, as we have seen. It is changing very fast. It's being an RNA virus. We know that RNA virus changes very fast. But yes, it is changing too fast that we are really having a trouble to find out where it is going now. So there was a challenge because this was a new virus. For us, it was a challenge in terms of knowing the symptoms, what it causes. Every month or every 2 months time, we find that a new kind of a symptoms comes. Then we find a challenge in terms of how to diagnose this virus. Then the third is about the treatment. So today, a very important is the diagnosis, because every time when we are talking about epidemiology, how to control this virus, every time it comes that testing and diagnosis. That is the only criteria of curtailing this pandemic, which is prevailing at present. Now, if we talk about investigation, which is rightly pointed out by National President and Dr. Lele also, that in investigation, it is very important when, why, and which of the investigation do. If we divide this investigation, I suppose we can divide this into two important aspects. One is the diagnosis of the virus, diagnosis of the illness, and the second is the prognostic value. How to see the prognosis of the patient also. So one part is a diagnosis, second is a prognosis of a patient, the third I will say serosurveillance, because I do not put that into a diagnosis and a prognostic value, it comes under the zero surveillance. So that is the third kind of diagnosis which are doing. So these are three important aspects, and I know for the control of the disease also, very important is to diagnose this virus. So for this kind of a, I think this kind of a symposium, I think Dr. Lele and the IMA can't choose a person who is more knowledgeable than Dr. Avinash Phadke. I think he is a very renowned pathologist in a circle. He is a president and mentor of Pathology Service of Super Religer Private Limited. He has been a director of India Ventures Healthcare Fund and Talwalkar Better Volume Fitness Club. And I think he has so many things to his credit. If I read on all the things, it will be, I think it takes most of the time, but still a salient feature of his advisor to Family Planning Association of India. And we have a very good forum. This is a forum of practicing private practicing pathologists. So he is an advisor, a mentor to all those things, and a vice chancellor to the friendly Prince Eli Khan Hospital, guest faculty to Tata Institute of Social Sciences, and a teacher to MD Pathology. So this is so many credit, and he has been awarded at so many fronts. I think the salient feature being and Professional of the Year award from Maharashtra Times, then Best Laboratory Award quality, and he has been awarded from the Quality Council of India, Maratha Udyog Bhushan Award, and India Today Survey Award, where he was chosen among the top pathologists. So we have such a renowned person. I think I'm not taking much of the time now. Now I'll request Dr. Avinash. There will be a presentation, and after that we'll devote time for 15 minutes for all of your questions. So this is how the things will be. So now over to Dr. Avinash, sir, please.
Thank you so much, Dr. Saini, and thank you, Dr. Jayesh Lele and my IMA friends. It's an honor for me to talk and give this presentation and have an interaction with you. Can you see me?
Yeah, your slides are there, sir.
Yeah, slides are there. Na? Okay. So it's an honor for me to be talking about COVID testing, when, why, and how. And this lecture is especially in the honor of late Dr. K.K. Agarwal, who was a pioneer in his own way. And right till the end, he continued his favorite passion of giving imparting knowledge to fellow colleagues and teaching and uploading videos on YouTube regarding COVID and variety of other things. So today's lecture is not going to be a purely pathological lecture, because that's of course very important, but how to interpret those tests in the context of clinical condition of the patient and how to extract maximum information out of any test in terms of managing the patient. And as Dr. Saini said, we are not talking only about diagnosis or prognosis. We are also talking in a critical phase of patient monitoring when the patient is seriously ill with COVID. So that is how the flow will go. And I hope that this is informative to all of you. Now, all of you know about RT-PCR testing as a gold standard for COVID diagnosis. Now, we just want to mention few salient points that there are different kinds of RT-PCR. What is RT-PCR? Is a reverse transcriptase PCR testing. What is reverse transcriptase? The RNA virus, which is in this case a coronavirus, is converted to DNA using an enzyme called as reverse transcriptase. And this DNA is then amplified in a PCR machine. That's why it is called RT-PCR testing and not PCR testing. If it was pure DNA virus, we would have called it only PCR testing. So this is the basic difference. The second is, we must know that the kit which we are choosing, ICMR has approved variety of kits. Just now, Dr. Saini mentioned about India facing what we call as currently labeled as Delta virus, where there are alterations in the spike proteins. So the mutations, there are two or three mutations in the spike protein, making diagnosis difficult. And also it has got ability to escape the antibodies which are produced by various vaccination. Now, we don't want to miss a diagnosis of COVID. So we choose a kit which has at least three antigens. So it could be N antigen, which is a nucleocapsid antigen or an envelope antigen or a spike protein gene or RDRP gene. There are a variety of genes, but we choose a kit which has at least three genes. So if one gene undergoes some alteration, in this case, if spike protein gene undergoes an alteration, you don't miss out in diagnosis of the test. Then I must briefly tell you that how the sample is collected. After the sample is collected in the viral transport media, it goes to lab, ICMR entry is done. And then what we do is aliquot the sample for what is called as RNA extraction. RNA extraction is nothing but to obtain RNA pellet from the sample collected in the viral transport media. This process is the first step, which is done on an automated instrument, and you can do up to 300, 400 RNA extractions in every half an hour on that platform. Once this RNA extraction is done, then the sample goes to a PCR machine. The newer PCR machines have reverse transcriptase enzyme, so it converts RNA into DNA and then it amplifies it. The number of times the virus needs amplification before a signal is picked up is called as a cyclical threshold value. So when we talk about CT value, it is nothing but the number of times the cycles are required before it is picked up as a signal by the instrument. So imagine if somebody has a higher viral load to begin with, fewer cycles will be required for the machine to pick up the signal. If somebody has a low viral load, then the number of cycles required to reach the level of detection will be higher. In other words, if you have a low CT value indicates a very high viral load. A value less than 10 is a very high viral load. And possibly it also indicates a very high degree of infectivity. I mean, this person is capable of transmitting the infection to others in a much larger way compared to a person whose CT value is 32, which indicates a low viral load and ability to transmit the virus is much less. The question which most clinicians ask is there any direct correlation between viral load? In other words, is there any direct correlation between CT value and the clinical behavior of the patient? Is it true that lower CT value means higher viral load and it means poor prognosis? Unfortunately, there is no clear-cut correlation between CT value and prognosis of the patient, because ultimately patient's immune response is something which determines how he reacts to this particular virus apart from the CT value. Secondly, the CT value is also dependent on the day and time and the nature of specimen. I will give you an example. What is the ideal time to do a COVID RT-PCR test? It should not be done for at least 36 to 48 hours after onset of first symptom. That means if somebody has cough, cold, loss of smell, fever, or diarrhea, the ideal time to do the RT-PCR should be between 36 to 48 hours and not immediately. That is because the rate of false negative RT-PCR, which should be normally around 10 to 15%, is as high as 40% if just done on day one. Virus is just beginning to multiply in the nasopharynx. So ideal time, as I mentioned, would be 36 to 48 hours when it has very high viral load. So if I would have done the test on day one immediately, my viral load would come less, my CT value will go high. If I do the same patient after 48 hours, by then the viral multiplication would occur. So viral load would be high and my CT value will go low. That's why there is no direct correlation between a CT value and the clinical outcome of the patient. This is very, very important because I have seen many clinicians telling the patient, ki aapka CT value agar kamti hai, that means you are going to have a serious COVID, which is not correct. Secondly, we must remember that the nature of specimen and the timing of specimen is very critical. For example, you do a chest CT on day 2, it is going to be normal in spite of having a low CT value and a high viral load. So you will say that this patient is going to do absolutely fine, but you do a chest CT after 8 days, the patient has COVID pneumonia with a high score on CT scan, and you happen to do a RT-PCR test on day 8 of the COVID when he has pneumonia from nasopharynx, and your false positivity rate is as high as 30 to 40%. The reason being, now the virus has shifted its location. It has shifted its location from nasopharynx to lungs. So in somebody coming to you after a week, probably a bronchoalveolar aspirate or sputum would be a better specimen than doing it from nasopharynx. I hope I have clarified the doubts about why 3 genes are important to test to avoid missing out any mutation or mutant virus, and what is the meaning of CT value. And we have just said that a low CT value indicates a high viral load, high infectivity, but not necessarily a bad outcome. After that, there is something called as an antigen test. All of us are using it, especially in rural population where facilities for RT-PCRs are not available. It's a good test. It's much better than not having a test at your disposal. But we must understand the limitations of this test. Though it is very useful for mass screening, the sensitivity is low. That means any patient with low viral load, patients with viral loads where your CT values are likely to be, say, 27, 28, or 30, these patients have low viral loads. They will be missed on antigen tests. So it has a low sensitivity, but it has a very good specificity. That means if the antigen test is positive, it is 90% accurate. But if it is negative, it's likely to miss out at least 30 to 40% of actual COVID patients. So any patient who is symptomatic, but antigen negative, there is a ICMR guideline which says that it has to be followed up with a conventional RT-PCR testing, and we cannot take negative test as absolutely accurate. But if the patient is symptomatic and positive, then there is no need to do RT-PCR. The test should be done in first 5 days to 7 days of the symptom. As I have mentioned, it can miss out cases where the viral load is low, and symptomatic negative need to be followed up with RT-PCR test. Then we come that you have patient RT-PCR is positive. The first investigation the clinician is going to ask is a simple blood count and a C-reactive protein. Now remember, in spite of having a battery of investigations at our disposal for diagnosis and monitoring of the patient, the most important are the simplest. That means a simple blood count and C-reactive protein are the most crucial investigations, not only in diagnosis, but on monitoring of the patient. We'll see how. The first, on CBC, you see lymphopenia. You see lymphocyte count as low as 15% or 20%. The absolute lymphocyte count is less than 1,000 per cubic millimeter. The NL ratio, that is a neutrophil lymphocyte ratio, which is normally 1.5:1 or 2:1, is greater than 3.13. But usually it is even 4 or 5. So your neutrophils could be 75 to 80% and lymphocyte could be 10 to 15%. Your patient also has eosinopenia, that means a low eosinophil count and a low platelet count. And RDWCV, which is a red cell distribution width, is usually increased. Now remember, lymphopenia correlates very well with the severity of illness. As I told you that your CT value doesn't correlate with severity of illness, but somebody has a severe lymphopenia is likely to do worse than somebody who has a mild lymphopenia. So if you have an asymptomatic patient whose COVID RT-PCR is positive, lymphopenia is seen in only about 20% of the patient. In moderate COVID, it is seen in about 50% of the patient. And in severe COVID, almost 85 to 90% of the patient will show a severe degree of lymphopenia. Now, this lymphopenia is different than the lymphopenia which we see in other RNA viral infections. Let's take example of HIV virus. All of us have dealt with HIV patient. We know that there is something called as CD4 and CD8, and an absolute value less than 500 per cubic millimeter of CD4 is a low value, and the ratio of CD4 to CD8 should be always greater than 1, and a lesser than 1 ratio generally indicates this patient is susceptible to have infections. In COVID, there is no selective depression of CD4. It's the across the board depression of all lymphocyte subpopulation. So you have decreased CD4, you have decreased CD8, and you have decreased natural killer cell. So just imagine a simple blood count, if done properly, has given us so much information. Of course, CD4, CD8 is not done routinely, but I mentioned it to show that this is a different lymphopenia than leukopenia, which we see, or a lymphopenia, which is selective decrease of CD4, which is seen in HIV patient. This is all populations and subsets of lymphocytes get depressed in patients with COVID. So a very critical indication. And similarly, a raised RDWCB, that is a red cell distribution width, is also an indicator which helps us. Then we come to simple C-reactive protein. Now, if you're asking for C-reactive protein, all of us know there is something called as hsCRP, that is ultra-sensitive CRP. What is it, the role of ultra-sensitive CRP? It detects from 0.2 milligram per liter to 20 milligram per liter. And it is generally done as a cardiac risk marker, because we know that atherosclerosis is not only a degenerative process, but it's an inflammatory process, and a raised C-reactive protein in a patient who is having ischemic heart disease or a cardiac failure is a prognostic marker. Now, that hsCRP has a measuring range up to 20. So we don't want to do ultra-sensitive CRP. You just ask for conventional CRP, which is done routinely, not a high-sensitive CRP. Because this has a measuring range up to 200. And in COVID, in all the patients, you are going to see values which are 40, 50, up to 200, 250 also. Apart from this, this is the most important parameter in patient management and diagnosis, because this is the parameter which is first one to rise. CRP is a parameter which will rise much before your IL-6 or D-dimer or ferritin rises. The beauty of this parameter is when the patient is hospitalized and you are monitoring patient's response to maybe antibiotic therapy for concomitant infection, or you are giving IV methylprednisolone to this patient, or you have chosen to give IV remdesivir, or you have given tocilizumab. All these are monitored by response of body in terms of monitoring the patient with his CRP values, because they alter immediately. So if I give IV methylprednisolone to the patient, the CRP will come down in 24 to 48 hours, while your ESR will take a very long time to go up and a very long time to come back. So no other marker except CRP can be used for day-to-day monitoring of the patient once he is hospitalized. Now, if the persistently high CRP you are seeing, in spite of patient is now not so bad, but his lung infection seems to be under control, but CRP and fever is persistently high, it usually indicates a concomitant bacterial or fungal infection, and you should specifically look for it. CRP and ferritin track the disease severity, though ferritin will lag behind. But early high CRP levels are closely associated with degree of pulmonary involvement on CT scan. So, moment you see a patient's value of one, let's say CRP value of 150, at the time of diagnosis, probably this patient has come to you on day 3, day 4, and his lung involvement has already started. So, that is the importance of doing CRP testing. Now we go to the next test, procalcitonin. What is the beauty of this test? This is a test normally used for all ICU patients for monitoring of sepsis. As you know, most of you know that in sepsis cases, there are guidelines that procalcitonin or lactate, these need to be done virtually daily because your antibiotic therapy response would be judged by changes in procalcitonin. If the procalcitonin is rising, that indicates a poorer response to antibiotic therapy for sepsis than a falling procalcitonin. Your WBC count changes lag behind. So your WBC could be 30,000. It will take time to come to below 20,000. But your procalcitonin post-antibiotic therapy will drop first. Now, in a COVID patient, we are always worried that whether he has any concomitant bacterial infection. So if your procalcitonin is normal, suppose your procalcitonin is normal value is less than 0.5 nanograms or 0.05 microgram. So if your normal procalcitonin or a low normal procalcitonin, which is less than 0.5, you have virtually ruled out concomitant bacterial infection or sepsis because it has excellent negative predictive value for sepsis. What is negative predictive value? That means you are able to rule out sepsis if the procalcitonin is absolutely normal or low normal. If the procalcitonin is higher than say 2 at the time of admission, probably you are dealing with a concomitant bacterial infection. You would probably ask for investigations like blood culture and other tests. So that is the importance. The half-life of procalcitonin is short. It's 24 or 36 hours. So it will rapidly respond to whatever antibiotic therapy you are starting in this patient. Serum ferritin, we all know that in COVID patient, usually it is used as a marker for iron store in the body. But in COVID, it's increased in variety of conditions, right from hemochromatosis to chronic liver disease to Hodgkin or an alcoholic patient. But in COVID patients, we are using it not as a measure of iron store, or like some people wrongly say that because mucormycosis will use this ferritin for its growth. So that's why we are monitoring. That is not the reason why you are using ferritin. You are using ferritin as an acute phase reactant. Acute phase reactant is it's an inflammatory marker which rises second after C-reactive protein. So if your ferritin goes to 1,000, 1,500 or 2,000, this patient has severe cytokine storm or macrophage activation syndrome. And this patient then has a guarded prognosis. But also remember that many COVID patients, when they are absolutely fine, their clinical symptoms have disappeared. Their C-reactive proteins have come to normal. They don't require oxygen support. There is no fever. Their C-reactive is normal. But ferritin and D-dimer can continue to remain high. So don't wait for the patient's ferritin and D-dimer to continue. Because it is high, patient needs to be in the hospital. If the patient is asymptomatic or clinically stable and C-reactive protein has come to normal, there will be a lag time before ferritin and D-dimer will come down. So remember this, because I have seen patient kept in the hospital because ferritin level is 800. Though he's clinically asymptomatic, he's roaming around in the ward, oxygen saturation normal, not receiving any treatment, but biochemical parameters like D-dimer or ferritin are high. So it's an acute phase reactant, but it will come down much more slowly than C-reactive protein or procalcitonin. So remember that this need not come to absolute normal before the patient gets discharged. Then we come to a very interesting molecule, which is called interleukin-6. Now we know that when patient is in a cytokine storm, the interleukin-6 values can go very high. So people ask me, what is the commonest cause of a raised interleukin-6 value? Normal value, as you know, is 0 to 7 picogram per ml. It should come high in COVID patient. It can go to 20, it can go to 50, it can go to 100. But remember, interleukin 6 false high readings are so common that unless a reading is rechecked, don't believe that interleukin 6, because many a times most of the hospitals or labs collect interleukin 6 in what we call as a red top plain bulb. And unless you separate the serum in half an hour and process it, the values from plain tube can change dramatically over a period of time. I will give an example. If the patient's sample is collected in a plain bulb without anticoagulant and IL-6 is done immediately, and if that patient's value was 5, if I separate the sample after transportation, now we have various lab chains where the sample reaches the processing hub after 3 to 5 hours. Till then it is in cold chain, but it is lying in a plain tube. And then somebody will separate it in an accessioning department. And by the time it is assayed, 6 hours have passed, then this 5 interleukin 6 value will become 50. So that kind of difference will happen. So how to avoid all this? Is there any way to avoid false positive? You insist that only EDTA blood collection should be done. EDTA plasma, interleukin 6 is stable if it is kept at 2 to 8 degrees. It is stable for 24 hours. So if I take EDTA bulb, collect blood sample, separate plasma, then I am safely can avoid these false elevations of interleukin 6. Now, another issue is, we all know that if the patient is in genuine cytokine storm, many a times a clinician decides that tocilizumab, which is normally used for rheumatoid arthritis patient, because these are the patient where interleukin 6 causes damage to the articular cartilage. And we use interleukin 6 receptor blocker, which is tocilizumab. So tocilizumab is a monoclonal antibody which blocks receptors of interleukin 6. Many a times we have seen that the clinician gives tocilizumab and then monitors the patient with interleukin 6 level next day. Suppose his interleukin 6 was 70 or 80 earlier, for which reason tocilizumab was given. Next day it goes to 100 or 120. Because what has happened? You have blocked the receptors of interleukin 6. You have not eliminated or neutralized interleukin 6. You have blocked the biological action of interleukin 6 without altering the biochemical value. To give you a corollary, I will give you a simple example. All of us use angiotensin receptor blockers in clinical practice as a preferred drug for hypertension. So all of us use azilsartan or olmesartan or telmisartan, which are essentially angiotensin 2 receptor blockers. So what happens to angiotensin 2 levels in this patient? If you do their angiotensin 2 levels, the angiotensin 2 levels are high. Because what we have done, we have blocked the biological activity of this angiotensin 2 in kidneys. But we have not eliminated angiotensin 2. So similarly, interleukin 6 is blocking the biological activity of tocilizumab. It is not neutralizing or eliminating tocilizumab. Then how do you see response to tocilizumab? You see response to tocilizumab by drop in CRP values and not drop in interleukin 6 values. Then we come to an investigation called D-dimer. As we know, the normal range is up to 500 nanogram. Now, here I wanted to tell you, D-dimer again is a very sensitive investigation. It is best done on certain platforms. So if you have automated coagulation platforms, it could be Stago, it could be Dead Bearing, it could be Sesmax, any automated coagulation platform, or what we call as an instrument called VIDAS, it comes very accurate. It's not so accurate if a lab is using biochemistry platforms. Suppose the lab is using biochemistry platforms for determination of D-dimer, the values then don't correlate very well with international standards. So just see that what platform is used. If D-dimer is genuinely elevated, what does it indicate? It indicates that this patient, especially if the values are twice the upper normal range, in this case, if the value goes to 1000, most of the clinicians would start thromboprophylaxis in terms of giving subcutaneous low molecular weight heparin, and then when the patient is discharged, they may continue giving oral anticoagulation for a length of time, because D-dimer may take up to 3 weeks post-discharge to come to normal. Now, when you are doing D-dimer, there is no need to do FDP also simultaneously, because what is D-dimer? When the fibrinogen degradation products are produced, D-dimer is that fraction of fibrinogen degradation products which is indicative of cross-linked diffraction, which is the earliest marker of thrombosis. So it will never happen that your FDP is raised, but D-dimer is normal. Vice versa can happen, that D-dimer is raised, but FDP is not so much raised. So no need to do simultaneous estimation of FDP and D-dimer. Just do a D-dimer value. A very high D-dimer value, of course, indicates a poorer prognosis. Now, we come for blood tests for fungal infection, because see, now we have talked about bacterial infection monitoring with procalcitonin. We have talked about cytokine storm monitoring with C-reactive protein and interleukin-6 and D-dimers. Now we come to fungal infection, which we are seeing increasingly. Now remember, though mucormycosis is a dreaded complication, there are other fungi. So most commonly we see Candida and Aspergillus. Mucormycosis is still, though it is dreaded, it's not as common as Candida or Aspergillus. So we have a test called galactomannan, which is a blood test for fungal infection, which is very specific to Aspergillus. So if galactomannan is raised, you know that you are dealing with probably Aspergillus species, and you will have to correlate with his CT scan finding, or may do a bronchoalveolar fluid for fungal culture. Unfortunately, galactomannan is not raised in cases of mucormycosis. We have another blood test for fungal infection called BD-glucan. BD-glucan is a test which detects beta-D-glucan, which is produced by Candida, Aspergillus, and pneumocystis. So if BD-glucan is raised, apart from Aspergillus, the other possibilities can be Candida or pneumocystis. Again, it is not raised in cryptococcal or mucor infections. Now we come to the current problem, which is the dreaded mucormycosis diagnosis. Now, most of the clinicians, most of the ENT surgeons, when they are doing operative work for mucormycosis, they need KOH preparation, just like an oncosurgeon needs a frozen section to determine what is should be the margin of resection, because he doesn't want to leave behind tumor which will then proliferate. A ENT surgeon doesn't want to leave behind unhealthy granulation tissue or mucor containing tissue, because then your amphotericin B is not going to reach the fungus. So he wants to remove as much as possible. So during surgery also, he may need a KOH preparation, which is a simple thing. Only remember, you use the intact specimen. Don't try to tease it. In 8 out of 10 cases, you are able to diagnose likely mucor on KOH preparation if the microbiologist is well trained. Some microbiologists use calcifluor dye, but then it requires a specialized equipment like fluorescent microscopy, which may not be available routinely across the country. Now, mucor is not a difficult fungus to grow. It grows very rapidly. Within 2 to 3 days, it would start growing. Once, which usual fungal media? You can use Sabarod's media, you can use potato agar. It grows on everything. So not a difficult species to grow. Now, identification can be easily done by a newer instrument called MALDI-TOF. MALDI-TOF is a mass spectrometry instrument which can give report of fungal species of any kind within 1 hour to 1.5 hours. But remember, you cannot use direct tissue samples on MALDI-TOF. You need to first grow them in a culture plate, and the culture colony is then tested with MALDI-TOF. So the culture may take 48 hours, but the identification of fungus will take hardly 1 hour or 2 hours, if you have MALDI-TOF. Then, of course, you have histopathology examination with HNE, PAS, and GMS-10. You tend to have high serum ferritin. All of us know that mucor thrives in presence of cofactors. If iron is there, it aids the growth of mucor. So this high ferritin also may be contributing to mucormycosis. Similarly, we have a newer diagnostic modality which takes about 8 hours to give mucormycosis diagnosis, which is a RT-PCR test. Report is available on the same day. You can send bronchoalveolar fluid, tracheal aspirate, sputums, pleural fluids. And if you want to identify and you have a confusion on a paraffin embedded block also, you can subject it to PCR later on. So this is important because we are dealing with a lot of mucormycosis cases at the moment. When your patient is in ICU, unfortunately, he may be on ventilator or just be on high flow nasal oxygen, you require many a times evaluation of concomitant co-infection. So we have an instrument called BioFire, which detects by molecular means what is a technology called film array. It is able to report on variety of pathogens. So you have a coronavirus, influenza, para-influenza, respiratory syncytial virus. So remember, coronavirus detection, apart from RT-PCR, can be done on BioFire panel today. And the report is available within 1.5 hours. So along with whether it's influenza, para-influenza, all that information is available with BioFire respiratory panel. The drawback is this test cost is very high. So generally performed in admitted patients in ICU setup, generally not performed on OPD basis unless the patient is very affording. The test cost is around 15 to 18,000. Then we have something called as BioFire pneumonia panel, because you are now seeing consolidation on CT scan. You want to know whether he has COVID pneumonia or now he has also developed staphylococcal or Haemophilus influenza or Pseudomonas, Klebsiella or Chlamydia pneumonia. All that information is available on BioFire pneumonia panel. Lastly, I come to the controversial topic of COVID antibody testing. What is controversial about it? We don't know how to use it well. Secondly, whether we need to use it and what purpose. See, if you are using for the purpose of sero surveillance, that means you just want to know what percentage of population has herd immunity and was infected in the past with COVID. You can do an older generation test which detects nucleocapsid antibody, which indicates past exposure to COVID infection. Nucleocapsid antibody test will be negative after vaccination. So vaccinated people will not show a positive older generation nucleocapsid antibody, but those who suffered from COVID, asymptomatic or symptomatic, will be positive for total antibody to nucleocapsid antigen. When you do spike protein antibody, this is a newer test. Now we know that whether it is COVID Shield or Moderna or Pfizer or Sputnik, all these vaccines are essentially producing antibodies against spike protein, because this spike protein is the one which allows viral entry into a cell by combining it with receptor binding domain and S receptors. So a spike protein antibody has an excellent correlation with neutralizing antibody. Neutralizing antibody is the gold standard for immunity. What it indicates that if I was to do viral neutralization studies with live or attenuated virus in a high safety lab, then I will know whether this person's antibody are able to neutralize the virus or not. But since we cannot do neutralization tests, though newer kits with neutralization antibody estimations are getting available now, we use spike protein antibody as a surrogate test because it has almost 86 to 87% correlation with neutralizing antibody. Now remember that 20% of your patient produce very poor antibody response in spite of receiving 2 doses of COVID Shield. I'm talking about COVID Shield because our data of about 4,000 cases and even ICMR data is mainly pertaining at the moment to COVID Shield because that started earlier. So 20% patient will develop poor response. 80% patients tend to develop good immune response. There are 2 to 4% of patients who develop no immune response in spite of two doses of vaccination. Now, people ask me, what is the level of adequate antibody response to judge the immunity? If you are doing it on Roche platform, it depends, it's platform specific. So on Roche platform was used for antibody tracking in Moderna trial for Moderna vaccine. 132 is adequate antibody data. Abbott platform was used for tracking Pfizer vaccine response. Their range will be different. But remember that the antibody response is at least fivefold in those patients who had COVID and then received vaccination. In other words, if the patient was having symptomatic or asymptomatic COVID and then he receives vaccination, his antibody titer is going to be at least five times than a person like me who never had COVID and just received two vaccinations. So a natural infection with vaccine combination produces a much greater immune response compared to only vaccination. That doesn't mean we need to have COVID, but this is an observation in all the studies. So that's what I have said, that a very, very high levels of spike protein antibodies are seen in recovered patients who have taken vaccination. And unfortunately, current guidelines are not clear as to what to do with those 18-20% of the patient in whom desirable antibody response is not produced. In other words, when you want to use antibody testing, use total antibody or a nucleocapsid antibody for surveillance of herd immunity or past exposure. When you want to judge the immunity, you have to ask for spike protein antibody. Because if you ask for nucleocapsid antibody after vaccination, nucleocapsid antibody will come negative because this patient never had COVID. So they don't have nucleocapsid antibody. So patient gets worried that my antibody test has come negative. That is because we didn't ask for spike protein antibody. As I have discussed, the vaccines are producing antibodies to spike protein and not nucleocapsid. So if you ask for a wrong antibody test for judging the immunity, it is going to be negative in a vaccinated population. I think I have covered most of the topic and thank you for giving this opportunity and giving me this chance to interact with my IMA colleagues and friends on occasion of Dr. K.K. Agarwal Memorial Lecture. And I would be happy to interact with you and answer questions if any. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Avinash. I think I was muted. Thank you, Dr. Avinash. I think a very lucid presentation you have done. Still, if people have doubt, they can ask questions. So please write your in the chat box. We will take down those questions. So I just read those if there are any in the chat box. So one chat box I'm just trying to open.
Dr. Sani, can I ask some question?
Yes, please carry on.
It was a wonderful deliberation regarding, it was again, you say that CT values and other values, they are not synonym to the severity, but the monoclonal antibodies cocktails have been coming. That is in the form of casimiramir and imdesivir. So what is your take on to that? That is one issue. Second, you said the HSCRP value, there is no relevance much in COVID-19, but CRP values would come down earliest and ferritin would come little later. So can you deliberate on to that?
No, see, I didn't say HSCRP values have no relevance. The HSCRP value is meant to detect very low levels of CRP. So if you ask for HSCRP test, you will get a report greater than 20. You want to know the exact value. So you want to ask for conventional CRP, where the measuring range is up to 200. Because in COVID patients, you are likely to see values like 40, 80, 100. I mentioned that COVID, the two most important tests are, in fact, CBC and C-reactive protein. C-reactive protein, even an ordinary C-reactive protein, of course, hsCRP will also rise in COVID. But if you get a value of 20 or 40, you don't need hsCRP. It's meant to detect 0.2 and 0.3 values. You use an ordinary CRP because then you are able to get a value and severity which is adequately informative. So you will get a value of, say, 140 on total CRP. While if you ask hsCRP value in this patient, you will just get a report greater than 20. Not that it will not be raised.
Dr. Asrani, I think it is just that it is very, it is costly also, but this is of no use because it is always, CRP will be very high in that case. Ultra-sensitivity is used only when you have a minimal rise of these things are there.
I agree, but the monoclonal antibodies, Dr. Saini, monoclonal antibodies, I had asked Casirivimab and Imdevimab, if at all people are using nowadays.
Yeah.
What is your take on that?
The response to monoclonal antibodies, again, will be judged by CRP estimations only.
That is not related to IL-6 values. Is there any role of LDH also?
LDH, of course, is a marker. It is useful, but I didn't see you will have LDH as a marker. People will use troponin as a marker, NT-proBNP as a marker, but that depends on a specific situation. So LDH is useful, but it's a non-specific marker. As you know, right from hemolytic anemia to liver conditions to heart condition to muscle, somebody is exercising also, LDH is elevated.
People are already taking dual antiplatelets. So are they need to be put on to low molecular weight heparin or to NOX, if at all NOX, you say yes, which NOX would be best? May it be a picture?
This is a clinical question. We can ask in another platform. This question can be asked in another platform.
I may not be able to guide you regarding how to manage a patient better. So, but from what I have observed, most of them are using low molecular weight heparin twice a day subcutaneously.
I will request everybody to please restrict to investigative part, not on a clinical part that can be taken in another platform. So I am reading one question which has come, Dr. Vinash. Now please, Dr. Israni, there's another question which has come with that IgM. People have write IgM and IgG antibodies. So Any take on that, Dr. Avinash? I think IgM antibodies.
The earlier generation tests, which were essentially detecting nucleocapsid antibodies, they were of three types. Either total antibodies, which comprise of IgG, IgM, and IgA. All three were determined. All were nucleocapsid antibodies. IgM nucleocapsid antibody rises slightly earlier than the IgG. But unlike what is our conventional wisdom that IgM always rises first and IgG rises later, the gap between the two is very narrow. So IgM starts rising between 5 to 7 days after COVID exposure. This is nucleocapsid antibody, not spike protein antibody. And IgG would rise after 7 to 9 days. So the earlier generation tests, which were essentially determining two things, whether the patient had exposure to COVID, we're using either total antibody, which is a combination of IgG-IgM, or only IgM antibodies. I hope that answers your question.
Take home message is, IgM at present is not standardized. It is also not available. No. If you want to detect infection, that RT-PCR or antigen is the only test. If you want to do a sero survey, then you go for total IgG antibodies. And available spike protein is the best point. Because neutralizing antibodies are still being standardized or very costly, so you can go for a spike protein antibodies. That's what it is.
Yeah.
Now absolutely. Somebody is asking Dr. Avinash, explain fall in platelet levels in COVID patients.
See, in most of the viral infections, you see fall in platelet. It could be because of suppression of viremia produces a bone marrow suppression, and unfortunately, a fall in platelet counts. And it's part of most of the illnesses. If you see a falciparum malaria, you will see this inflammatory site. Now, by the way, if you do the same markers, C-reactive protein, D-dimer, ferritin, in a case of falciparum malaria, they are highly elevated. The thing is, we never do it. But accidentally, when the patient is referred to us, and we tend to do, because they think everybody is having COVID, but many a times suspected COVID turns out to be malaria. By then, all these tests are performed, IL-6, D-dimer, ferritin, C-reactive protein. And you will see all these markers, inflammatory markers are high, even in cases of falciparum malaria. Only thing is, we don't normally ask them in cases of falciparum malaria. So viremia is causing this resultant bone marrow suppression. It is causing lymphopenia. It is causing maximum suppression of T cell subpopulation of lymphocyte. So as I mentioned, CD4, CD8, natural killer cell. And this is why the response of T cell immunity. Now, when we talk about T cell immunity, these T cells would have produced gamma interferon to combat with viruses. If their population gets suppressed, our ability to combat viruses, to reduce viremia also gets reduced. So platelet is a part of generalized bone marrow suppression response.
So thank you so much. I think generalized suppression after bone marrow, it will lead to lymphopenia as well, platelet coming down. Another question, important question people have asked, I think it's a correlate to our vaccination program also. Is spike protein antibodies effective? I think what my take on that is Delta virus found in India is effective against Delta virus. We have seen that all the vaccination program which is happening, they are effective against all kind of variants so far available. So my take is it will be effective. So your Dr. Avinash.
Yeah, it is effective, but the percentage of effectiveness drops down. So for example, there are various studies which are performed on COVID shield, Sputnik, and even Pfizer. The ability to neutralize Delta virus is much less than their ability to do neutralize the earlier generation virus. So you are absolutely right that they will prevent serious illness or death, but their ability to prevent mild or moderate infection definitely comes down in cases of Delta virus. That is what the studies are showing so far.
Somebody has asked, is LDH or procalcitonin same? I think they are different as they are already.
No, both are entirely different. Both are entirely different. Procalcitonin is a very specific marker for bacterial infection. LDH is not a marker for bacterial infection. LDH is a marker for muscle injury, for cardiac injury, for liver injury. Maximum values are seen in cases of hemolytic anemias. So it's also getting liberated from red blood cells. So LDH is a marker of variety of conditions, and it's not specific to bacterial infection.
Always remember, procalcitonin is for bacteremia. If you want to know whether person is having bacteremia or the prognostic of that, do this test, procalcitonin. Okay, somebody has asked a question, a patient aged 12 years, RT-PCR positive, but with D-dimer level of 2016, other parameters and clinical condition normal, is it a lab error or indicator for something?
No, as I mentioned, if the lab error is ruled out, I mentioned that which platforms to believe in terms of D-dimer, because you require saturated blood and a platform where reliability is absolute before taking any conclusion on this patient, but it can happen. And if it is genuinely high, of course, patient will need thromboprophylaxis.
And secondly, as you rightly mentioned before, also 2016 is a very high level, but still, D-dimer take a longer time to come normal as compared to CRP.
Take a long time.
It can be a normal condition also. The clinical condition has to be observed in this case. So,
when the patient gets discharged, you will see that the D-dimer still is around 1,000 and he has to continue oral anticoagulation for a period of 3 to 4 weeks before it completely becomes normal.
That's what I have also seen. Number of times patient keeps on calling that my D-dimer is higher, but my CRP is normal. Even clinicians even talk about this. So this is what I think has been told to everybody by Dr. Avinash also, and my experience also the same, that D-dimer takes a longer time. And CRP is the much better prognostic test to be done as compared to other tests. If you have a choice, you get that all the tests done. But if you have done to do one test for that kind of a thing, then I think CRP is the better one. What do you take, Dr. Avinash, on that?
No, I fully agree with you. That's why I mentioned the most important and critical tests are the simple blood count and CRP. it doesn't mean the others are not helpful. They are very important, but these two are the most crucial tests for patient monitoring.
Somebody has asked a question, which has, I think, a repeat question. How long it will take for D-dimer to return to normal after mild COVID? I think Dr. Avinash has covered already.
Yeah,
it takes around 3 weeks time.
Yeah.
3 weeks time when you become normal. So anybody who want to ask a question, or otherwise I just sum it up and great presentation. We have around more than 200 participants in this. So very well attended seminar. Any question so far? So no question, then I think I really thank Dr. Lele and our national president for organizing this kind of a seminar. And what a lucid presentation Dr. Avinash has given. Just summing it up is that what has been told, that the first and foremost still remain for a diagnostic versus the RT-PCR test. And when this RT-PCR is to be done, that is also to be done very carefully. Just after between 36 to 48 hours of the symptoms, if you do early and late, then might be your test may not come. And secondly, which our clinicians spend most of the time asking for CT value as a prognostic marker, please do not keep this as a prognostic marker. CT values has not as a prognostic marker to be used. But if you want to use a prognostic marker, then it is the CRP, which is the most important prognostic marker, which I think Dr. Lele is raising hand. So please, Dr. Lele.
That's okay. I want to thank Dr. Avinash I'm today very much delighted. I heard this lecture. I'm hearing it again, but still so many new points, I was grasping it. Let me tell everybody that Avinash is my classmate from 1972 batch from KM Hospital. And we are very, really proud. Many some students are also there. Second thing, Dr. Saini sir and Dr. Avinash, this is available on YouTube as well as Facebook. So the link will be sent to you as well as to anybody who wants to just download it, listen to it. They can go anytime. This will be available permanently on our website as well as on the Facebook. That's what I just wanted to mention it. Go ahead, sir.
So I was just summarizing the things. So it takes, your RT-PCR is the only test at present. You can go for antigen, but it has a low sensitivity, but a high specificity. So if you have a antigen positive, then no need to go for an RT-PCR. But if your antigen is negative, then you should, if the symptoms are still not, you are confused, then please go for RT-PCR. And then for a prognostic value, it is ratio of neutrophil and lymphocyte, which is important, which Dr. Avinash very well said that is 3. If more than 3.1, that is very significant. There is a relative lymphopenia is there. Then there is no use of going for an ultra-sensitive. It's a costly test also, but it has no value. Just going for a normal CRP will give much more things to do. Then go for procalcitonin also, because that will tell us about the bacterial infection if it is happening simultaneously. Then ferritin and IL-6, very elaborate. Dr. Avinash has covered that IL-6 values. And very importantly, how you take that sample. Do not give it in a serum sample, which most of the time will be happening. Because when we go as a collection center to some places, its general feeling is that it takes in a serum. Unless and until you have separated it out fast, then it will give a high result. So, but this is happening in a reverse manner. Most of the tests come below normal. If you are taken a longer time here, the values become higher. Dr. Avinash, that's what
yes,
it is.
Yes, so, values become very high.
Very high. And do not monitor tocilizumab monitoring with IL-6. Because that will be just confusing for the clinician friend. I know they people be knowing, but most of the time we give a drug and we feel that IL-6 should come down. That we have seen many times the question has been raised to us. So please do not monitor IL-6 with tocilizumab. Tocilizumab you monitor with CRP values, which Dr. Avinash has emphasized. So with and for mucormycosis, as a microbiologist, I can say the best test still available is if you give us a simple QH preparation, if we do, we find this hyphae and immediately the treatment can be started. That I think the best test which can be do on that. Culture comes later on, but this QH preparation, that's the best thing. I think with this, I think it was a very good elaborate presentation, very good audience, Very good presentation. Thank you very much, IMA. Thank you very much, Dr. Lele, and our national director.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, okay. As now,
thank you.
Thank you.
No, I just wanted to thank Dr. J.S. Lele as well as Dr. Saini and all our IMA friends for listening patiently to me and giving me this opportunity. We will stay in touch. Thank you once again.
Sure.